Well, again, Ken. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. It is a pleasure to be back here with you. I appreciate everything that all of those who spoke before me had to say, and I just want to drive home this year's point. You will never live through a more important election. You haven't yet, and I don't think you ever will. If you do, this country's got another problem. If you ever picked a year to leave it all on the field, 2012 is the year. And you all in Iowa, like I am in Virginia, are a swing state. Now, unlike you all, until 2008, no Democrat had ever won Virginia for the presidency in my life. Well, we're going to try to return Virginia to the winner's column while you all do the same thing right here in Iowa. I was asked today to talk about federalism and federalism in action, which we've been doing in my office, and pushing back on the federal government and the role of states in that, kind of a 50,000-foot subject, but that this administration has made very, very real. You know, before taking on the typical prosecutorial duties of an attorney general, which most people associate with the office, the first thing in my oath of office, the very first thing, is to uphold and protect the U.S. and Virginia constitutions. That's the very first thing in my oath of office, and I take that very, very seriously. When the government, the federal government, got to specify here, the federal government decides to break a law or oversteps the boundaries of the Constitution, as this administration is doing, when they harm Virginia, when they harm the other states, I will push back, and there are other attorneys general that will push back. It's why I was here 2 years ago campaigning for Brenna Finley, because I knew she would push back. Tom Miller doesn't do that. So as long as the list of speakers is up here, speaking, you know, kind of parochially as an attorney general, you need one more at least, in addition to a Senate majority leader. So. Now, I will say, I think the federal government, since I took office, I jokingly say I was sworn in at the beginning of 2010 and January 16th and sworn out on January 17th, and it's kept up pretty steadily since then. But the federal government has been overstepping its boundaries that whole time, overstepping the boundaries of the law and, more seriously, of the Constitution. So I've been very busy pushing back. And I'll tell you, step one is simply fighting. I tell people all the time in politics, at the grassroots, and I'm a grassroots guy, I've been outspent in all of my races. It's never been a goal, it's just worked out that way. But we've won them all. We've won them all because people committed to the first principles of this country, which is the foundation of every campaign that I've ever run, have come out of the woodwork to get us over the top. And we promised those folks and all of Virginia that we would protect those first principles, even if that meant protecting them from the federal government. And that's what we've been doing. And frankly, I've been kind of busy doing that since I became Attorney General. I'd like to be more bored. Come January 2013, we're pulling for boredom in my office. Now, but between now and then, we are an active participant in federalism. And of course, everybody remembers separation of powers. It's talked about a lot more, the division between the legislature, the executive, and the judiciary. Federalism I refer to as vertical separation of powers between the federal government and all the state governments. And it was designed that way. It was designed that way. If you can spare 20 pages of time, read Federalist 45 to 51. Let me see. I think that was written by, oh yeah, Virginian. How about that? James Madison, where he talked about that separation of power in a vertical sense between the states and the federal government, where it was intended that we would push back on one another when either of those levels of government got outside of the Constitution. And that has happened through our history. And right now it is the states, a majority of states, suing the federal government to protect the U.S. Constitution from the federal government. That's what we're doing in the healthcare case. We're protecting our own Constitution from the federal government that was founded effectively in that Constitution. It's historically extraordinary. And the Founding Fathers intended for us to provide that check on the federal government out in the states, and we're doing that. It was interesting, in the district court in Richmond, the lawyer for the federal government got up. His name was Ian Gershengorn, and he got up, as he, you know, has many cases before, and said, "Good morning, Your Honor, Ian Gershengorn for the government. I mean, the federal government." Because there were two governments in court that day, suing one another. And that's part of what the federal courts are for, is for these disputes of authority. We are blessed in many ways in this country. One of them is that we fight these battles for first principles today peacefully, not as they did over 200 years ago, and as over a million people in this country have given their lives to defend those same first principles. We don't have to put at risk what the first 56 put at risk. When they signed the Declaration of Independence and pledged their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor, many of them gave their lives, gave their fortunes, but none of them sacrificed their sacred honor. But they put it all on the line. And no one here will be asked in the next 6 months and one day to risk anything like they did. We have no excuses. We have been too blessed for excuses. And I expect out of you all, just as I do for myself, 6 months of some of the hardest political work that you will ever put in your lives. And I'll tell you what, we're not called to win, but we are called to fight. And you put everything you can into this fight, and I know Iowa will come out on the right side. I know you all can do it. I know you can do it. And when we do that, we've got to reverse some trends. We've been asking as a people for government to do more and more of this and that, and every time all government ever asks of us is just a little bit more of our liberty, just a little bit more here and a little bit more there. And now we have a central government that plans and tries to regulate every aspect of our economy and much of our lives. We don't have a responsive federal government that we control, but people are getting fed up. They've been getting fed up. Today, the idea of federalism's reemerging. I mean, when Brenna was running 2 years ago here in Iowa, I mean, the federalism was a topic on the campaign trail, as it was for other AGs I went and campaigned for in other parts of America. You mentioned Oklahoma earlier. Scott Pruitt won in Oklahoma, and opening an office of federalism within his attorney general's office was a plank of his platform. When have you ever heard federalism discussed in a campaign until the last 2 years? And now, because it is so intimately connected with the preservation of the foundation of this country, we hear it quite a bit, and I'm glad we do. If we've got this lousy bill we've got to try to get rid of, we ought to at least teach people some lessons, whether they're Republicans or not, so that we don't repeat these mistakes in the future. That's part of our job, it's part of our responsibility, and part of how we do that, of course, is not just by pushing back on the federal government, but explaining it along the way and bringing voters over. You know, the conservative sales pitch is tougher than the liberal sales pitch. The liberal sales pitch is easy. Here's a check. You vote for us, keep us in power, and the checks will keep coming. That's pretty easy. They do the feel-good thing and so on and so forth. For conservatives, it's more intellectual. It's setting up a system where when our children are our age, opportunity will still be available to them. And opportunity is just liberty in the economy. And this administration is suffocating liberty. For us now today, and for our children 10 and 20 and 30 years from now. And that's what we have to stop on November 6. The worst example, of course, of this is the federal health care bill, passed largely against the majority, the will of the people, as demonstrated continuing by the polls that get worse and worse and worse for it as time goes on. So I guess Nancy Pelosi was right about that part, that now that they passed the bill, we can find out what's in it. And the more people learn, the less they like it, shockingly enough. That's just because Americans are smart. They wise up. Virginia was the first state to go to court. We waited 35 minutes or so after the president signed the bill and filed suit. Now, I'm a amateur historian, and I didn't realize this until the night of. The president, of course, signed the bill March 23rd, 2010. That was the 235th anniversary from 1775 of Patrick Henry's Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death speech, which was fairly ironic, I thought, given that this piece of legislation was one of the greatest erosions of liberty in our lifetimes. Even more ironic was the fact that didn't occur to me till I was on a conference call that night, about 9:30, kind of a light bulb went off, where we filed suit in the 700 block of East Broad Street in Richmond, was 17 blocks directly east on the same street where he gave that speech, 235 years later, on the same street, 1.12 miles, according to Google Maps. Have we come full circle or what? And I will tell you, as Virginia's Attorney General, first of all, I believe that the earthquake in Virginia was caused by James Madison rolling over in his grave. That's where it was in Virginia. And second of all, these first principles that we're defending in this case were first articulated and best articulated in Virginia by Thomas Jefferson in the Declaration, James Madison, the father of the Constitution, and Patrick Henry, who browbeat them all into the Bill of Rights. It's very appropriate for us to be leading that charge. And as we wait here about a month and a half, probably the last week of June, to find out whether we still have a government of limited and enumerated powers or not, Virginia is going to be there for whatever fight comes out of there. We're going to be there again as long as I'm Attorney General. And I know that so many of you have stood with us in elections. You know, you've got critical congressional races this year. Steve King is one of my very favorite congressmen, no disrespect to any of the others, but I probably spend more time with Steve on Capitol Hill than anybody else, so sorry, Steve. But anyway, you know, our argument in this case is that the federal government does not have the authority to order you what to buy. They've never tried to order you what to buy before. They've never done that. Let me tell you just how historically unprecedented this is. You know, when we have a case like this that lawyers call a case to first impression, there's never been one like it, we go back to the beginning. We look at why they wrote this part of the Constitution the way they did and the history of it. Well, this is a Commerce Clause case. It's not a Tenth Amendment case. It is, can the federal government compel you to buy a product in order to regulate you? That's what they're doing here. So we go back before the Revolutionary War, and for the 10 years before, we were boycotting British goods, almost exactly 10 years. And during that time, there was a lot of debate, both in governors' councils in the colonies, because we were not citizens, we were subjects, and over in Parliament on the other side of the Atlantic. And the Attorney General and Solicitor General for the King at that time sat in Parliament by tradition, and they were asked, isn't this boycott by the colonists treason? Pretty important question for obvious reasons. And the answer was, the colonists have come right up to the line, but they have not crossed it. Well, think about that. Flip that coin over. That's an admission that they couldn't order us to buy British goods. But we have a president who believes he can. That is how historically unprecedented this exercise of power is. King George III didn't try to do it. But Barack Obama thinks he can. And we'll see what the Supreme Court has to say about it, but America has a say in this too. And let's say we win, and the whole law is ripped out by the roots. America can't have a president who thinks he can dictate to each and every one of us what we buy and how we live, as this president believes he can, to conform with his left-wing agenda. We can't have that in America, and the only way to stop it is on November 6th. It's absolutely critical that we take that responsibility deadly seriously. And it's great to have more Republicans registered, but more have to show up. And we got 6 months to make sure they show up and to convert more of them, You know, as we go through this case, the federal government basically argues that your decision to do nothing, to buy nothing, to not buy the product they want you to buy, is the same as economic activity. They have a little trouble with their definitions. Activity is the same as inactivity. I jokingly tease their lawyers that I think the founding father they have the most trouble with is Noah Webster. They don't appreciate that a whole lot. Well, that's okay, get right. And I'll stop teasing you about that. Obviously, the Supreme Court heard the case at the end of March. On the mandate, the federal government had one challenge when they walked into that courtroom. They had to explain to the Supreme Court something they hadn't explained anywhere else in any of the hearings up to that point. And that is, if ordering you to buy health insurance is somehow constitutionally unique, how is that power quarantined? What makes it so unique for legal purposes that they won't show up to order you to buy asparagus, and it was good tonight, but it's asparagus, and or to buy a health club membership or buy a car? The legal principles are the same. You know, I have a theory. I think they're going to make you buy a GM. They got some interest in GM these days, and I actually have more particular theory about it. They're going to make you buy a Chevy Equinox. Now, I own a Chevy Equinox. You don't want to own a Chevy Equinox. And that's exactly why that's the one they're going to order you to buy. If it stops moving, subsidize it, you remember? Well, Chevy Equinox is for everyone. Hopefully not. Hopefully we won't go there. Hopefully the Supreme Court will return us to the foundational principles for the Commerce Clause and put this government back inside the constitutional box that it belongs in. We'll find out at the end of June. This lawsuit is not about health care, because if we lose, you got the cars, you got the asparagus, so on. It's about liberty. You can take health care and health insurance out of this bill and put cars and put food and put anything else in there, and the legal principles are the same. So the question is, does this government have this dictatorial power over your life or not? I don't think the founders, not one of them, not even Alexander Hamilton, would say yes. New Yorkers, you know, what are you going to do? But this would be extraordinary. But if we win, we have stopped the ball rolling from the New Deal. We have stopped, finally, the ever-expanding realm of government power, according to the Supreme Court. There's a lot at stake when this order comes out. And there's the opportunity for a lot of great news. And we shall see. But the brazenness of this administration in overstepping these boundaries and trampling the Constitution. You know, Steve mentioned property rights in my introduction. That's something that I've worked for 8 years on. We have a constitutional amendment in Virginia this year. It took me, if we win, about 2 months short of 8 years in that effort. And I've been there every year, as the opponents will tell you. I've been beating the heck out of their knuckles with my face. I don't recommend it, but it looks like it's going to work. And when we were debating that one time, I want to say 5 years ago, the majority leader, now majority, well, no, Republicans have our, we have a 2020 Senate, so I'm not quite sure how to say it. But the leader of the Democrats, how about that, stood up on the floor and said, property rights don't belong in the Constitution. Thankfully, he said it 2 days in a row. It's one of those things that you hear and you think, he didn't just say that. He didn't just say that. And he did say that. You know, a lot of people take the Constitution for granted. In Virginia, the vote to ratify the Constitution was 88 to 80. Four votes out of 168 go the other way, no Constitution. In New York, it was two votes, 31-29. One vote goes the other way, no New York. Patrick Henry, James Monroe, that would be future President James Monroe, George Mason voted against the U.S. Constitution in Virginia's state ratifying convention because it did not protect exactly those kinds of individual rights. Ladies and gentlemen, that's what we're facing on the other side. They think the Constitution is a quaint piece of art from the 18th century. Looks nice on the wall, but we don't need to worry about it as we go about the business of governing your lives, not your government, and your society, not your government. Constitutions govern government. At least they're supposed to. And as attorneys general, we're the last line of defense when the federal government oversteps those boundaries. When there aren't enough folks in Washington to rein in the federal government, or they're not committed enough to rein in the federal government, and we've had both, and we've had Republicans in this category, then it falls to states to push back, and we are pushing back. But it's a defensive position. You know, we need cavalry. That's what November 6th is about. We need to get back on offense. We need to start shrinking this government, not shrinking the increase, shrinking the government. And one of the issues this year is the rule of law itself, because while I've just talked through, and the case is those two positions, it's our side that says you can't order us to do this, you don't have any power in the Constitution to do it, and the federal government that says your thought to do nothing is economic activity, and so we can regulate that. That's the difference in that case. But it is only one example of more than a score of examples I could give you of violations of the law or the Constitution by this administration. The rule of law itself is at stake in this election. Make no mistake about it. You know, before Steve mentioned I was green when I filed this suit. I'd been in office 2 months and a week. But that was the second lawsuit. The first one was against the EPA, which I've taken to calling the Employment Prevention Agency, because, well, they're so good at that. If there was a C in the title, I'd fit crucifixion in there somewhere, but that is how they operate. The EPA, the NLRB, the FCC, the president's recess appointments, the list goes on and on and on of violations of the law itself. And I want to share with you to close a thought, a quote from Ronald Reagan that I always look back on when I think about these fights, because they are. Every one of them is its own fight, and it's its own defense of the Constitution and of the structure of government that the founders delivered to us. And you all have heard at least part of this quote. I know you all have. Freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. We didn't pass it to our children in the bloodstream. It must be fought for, protected, and handed on for them to do the same. And most people stop there. But I'm more pessimistic than most people. And I'm a conservative. There are consequences. So let's finish the quote and hear the consequences. And do the same for them. Or one day we will spend our sunset years telling our children and our children's children what it was once like in America, where men were free. Well, as long as I'm running for office and as long as I'm in office, I'm going to fight for that freedom, and I want you to join me for the next 6 months, and we're going to have a new America come 2013. God bless every one of you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, sir. Great job. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ken Cuccinelli, everybody.